Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to the 22nd meeting of 2020 of Scotland's Social Security Committee. We have a full house of MSPs this morning. No apologies have been received, and we will move to agenda item one, which is decision to take an item in private. The committee is asked to agree that item three, consideration of evidence that we will hear today, to be taken in private. Now, I'm going to assume that MSPs are content with this unless anyone indicates in the chat box now. I'll give a few moments for that. Okay, we are agreed, thank you. And we move to agenda item two, which is COVID-19 and Social Security. And this is the committee's second evidence session on its inquiry on the role of Social Security in the response to and recovery from COVID-19. We have two panels this morning, and can I welcome our first panel, who are Sally Dyson, Head of Digital Participation, Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, and Martin Canavan, Head of Policy and Participation, Aberlour. You're both very welcome. Thank you for supporting our inquiry. And we will move straight to questions. And the first question is from Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, and good morning to the panel. My question is just in regard to how the money has got down to the grassroots. I think about 80 million of investment has been made available through community funding packages. From your conversations and experience, has that money got down to the grassroots organisations? Has it impacted local communities? And going forward, how can we make sure that money reaches not just for kind of big organisations, but the small grassroots organisations which are dealing maybe with local communities? I'm happy for Ira to answer, Camino.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's take Sally Dyson first. Sally.
Morning. Thanks for that question. I think it's really important because it's critical that we get, you know, funding down to local people. So from SCVO's perspective, we were supporting the Wellbeing Fund, which was £50 million of the emergency funding. And we did that through supporting lots of voluntary organisations, over 1,000 organisations across every community and neighbourhood in Scotland. And to make sure that the money got down there really effectively, we had a really brilliant partnership of organisations. So we had some national funders who were able to bring their really rapid funding expertise to the fore. And we also had representation through the assessment and the communication of all of the local third sector interfaces. So what we were able to do was to really gain their knowledge and their expertise of who was doing fantastic things within local communities and combine that with the funder knowledge. And so we're now getting lots of monitoring information back from those organisations that have been funded, which was really light touch in line with everything that we wanted to do. And so we're starting to see the views of the impact that that's having. And some of that, you know, we know from immediate responses was around, you know, food parcels being dropped on people's doorsteps. It was about packages that supported people's health and well-being, you know, being delivered to them both digitally and where it was safe, again being dropped on people's doorsteps. Everything from, you know, colouring kits for kids through to some, you know, online movement sessions that were really helping people. So I think that combination of that scale stuff that we could do at a national level and bringing in the expertise from a local level was absolutely critical to us being able to see that impact.
I'm Martin Canavan.
Hi, good morning, and thank you, panel, for inviting me along this morning. An answer to your question, Jeremy. Yeah, I think, as Sally has outlined kind of widely across the sector, there has been a really excellent distribution of a lot of the money that's been made available from the various funding streams to the Scottish Government. Speaking from Aberlour's perspective, we've been able to benefit by being in receipt of some of that money through the various funding streams from the Scottish Government and being able to make sure that that's been directed and distributed directly to families and to communities. In some ways, that has been working in partnership with local authorities and with other third sector organisations to deliver certain forms of support, food packages, food parcels locally for families during the course of the pandemic. More directly, however, I think where it's been really beneficial for Aberlour specifically and for the families we work with rely on us has been the money that's been directed from Scottish Government directly through our Urgent Assistance Fund, which has allowed us to get money directly into the pockets, cash directly into the pockets of families who desperately need it. And while that's been through our fund, that's also allowed us to work more closely with some local, smaller community-based organisations that represent particular groups of families and communities, where we were able to make sure that that money through our fund was getting to the families that they work with and they support also. So I think on the face of it, and in a kind of immediate sense, as a crisis response, the funding that's been made available through Scottish Government has been able to be distributed fairly well in the short term, certainly in our experience.
Yep, Jeremy?
Just very briefly, I mean, thank you for those answers. Sally, I think it might be helpful if you could maybe provide the committee with some of those stories and some of that feedback, because I think that might help us with our inquiry. Just going forward, I mean, clearly we don't know what the next 3 to 4 or 5 months are going to bring, but clearly there's going to be a very important role for the third sector, whatever happens. How would you see the distribution of any more monies being made available? Because certainly some of the feedback I got back early on was that your very small organisations were still struggling to be able to access that money. And I just wonder, is there any way, other ways we can make it easier for the very small charities to do that?
So I think, again, that's a really useful question, and that's some really useful thinking that we're doing on reflecting on particularly the Wellbeing Fund, which was the fund that SCVO was most involved in. In terms of stories of impact for local organisations, we're just pulling a report together that we're going to publish very soon, and we can make sure that that's available directly to you with some of the statistics, but also some of those really heartwarming stories of the impact that that had. So I'll definitely make sure that that comes out to you. In terms of the learning, we took lots of the learning from the Wellbeing Fund and the partnership work there. And that Wellbeing Fund was really interesting because within sort of 7-8 days of the pandemic being announced, we, as a coalition of funders, were able to get small amounts of money, £1,000, £2,000, out to really small organisations. And there was no process there other than we had a really good relationship with lots of those organisations anyway. But we picked up the phone and spoke to those organisations and asked them, could some, you know, emergency funding help you immediately? And the answer was almost always yes. And it was brilliant that we had the authority from Scottish Government to be able to do that. Obviously, there were some checks and balances in there. So I think there was also then a bid-in round, which was a really simple application form for larger amounts of money. And as I say, across the whole of it, we had over 1,000 organisations. That's a good start, but we need to go further. And I think we're now in a period where we can just do that reflection very quickly, and we've started that work. Working with third sector interfaces was really, really important. And we also actually had a process whereby we were having conversations with organisations that we funded to talk to them about, did they locally know of other organisations that were doing some great stuff that could help as well? So expanding that network of organisations that we knew we were doing brilliant stuff to get money to them.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Okay. Now, I was going to come to the next theme, but Jeremy's line of questioning actually leads on quite nicely. So I'll take you in shortly, Tom Arthur, okay. Now, I did note from the funds that there were some underspend. So I think the Supporting Communities Fund was underspent by around £19 million or something. There was a small underspend in the Wellbeing Fund. And I noted that the Scottish Government created the Third Sector Community Recovery Programmes. I'm just wondering if the underspend identifies an issue with getting the money out, or that there was a sufficiency of fund and it was right and reasonable to package that up and refocus that spend. So I'm just wondering if any of our witnesses want to comment on that. Sally, do you want to come in? I saw you nodding your head there, Sally Dyson.
Yeah, I didn't quite get my finger to the R key to put in the chat box. So we weren't centrally involved with the Community Recovery Fund, but one of the things that Scottish Government asked SDVO to do and we wanted to do was to set up a coronavirus information hub. And a key part of that, and a part of that that was most visited and appreciated, was we were working with funders, with funds from Scottish Government, with independent funders, with grant and trust funders, to talk to them in the immediate aftermath of the pandemic being called, to find out what they were doing to support the organisations that they might already have a relationship with. And what we know is that lots of those organisations were already in contact and they were freeing up grant funding, so de-restricting it, and essentially just saying to organisations, if you need to use this money in a different way to respond to what you're seeing in front of you, then go ahead and do it. Don't ask us, tell us when you've done it and tell us, you know, the stuff that you've done. So the emergency funding was absolutely critical, but there was a lot of funding that was around initially, and people were able to be really flexible with what they were doing, which was amazing. And very rapidly we knew that, you know, this wasn't going to be a few weeks, a small number of months, that it was going to stretch on into the distance, and that communities needed to look at how they wanted and could respond over the longer term. So actually with the funding pattern as it's flowed, so that we, you know, we do now have the Communities and Third Sector Recovery Fund, which is looking very much at how do we establish more resilience within communities and community organisations to help people's changing needs. That funding profile, it's really great that that was there. We knew it was there, and we knew that it was secure and that we'd be able to develop and learn and do some things different with the funding to meet the ongoing needs of communities.
That's helpful, Sally. I suppose I was just trying to ascertain that any underspends wasn't an inability to get the cash to where it had to be within the third and voluntary sector. But that was reassuring. Martin Caravan, do you have any comments in that area?
Yeah, just to say that I can only really speak on in response to the funding and the funding streams that Aberlour was able to access, and the money that was distributed to us through those funds by the Scottish Government. I think we would have been more than happy to channel as much of the funding the Scottish Government made available through our Urgent Assistance Fund, for example, to get it directly to families. And I know there's other organisations that operate hardship funds that would have similarly been happy to distribute as much of that money as the Scottish Government made available. The one caveat being that, you know, organisations as we are, albeit Aberlour are a national charity and a relatively large organisation in that sense, we do have capacity issues in terms of how that could be administered, and so that there were limitations, or there are limitations, in terms of how much money or funding we were able to distribute. However, I would say that in terms of some of the funding that hasn't been distributed, the one thing I would maybe, and thinking towards recovery, the one thing I would maybe suggest that Scottish Government might need to consider is how some of that funding might now be made available, for example, to help and support services and support services that are struggling with capacity, and particularly in some of the larger organisations that might not be eligible for some of the smaller tranches of funding that's available just now in terms of the recovery fund. I think what we found is that the rising level of need that we've been able to respond to in relation to the Urgent Assistance Fund and other charitable hardship funds to get money directly to families, we've also seen a corresponding rise in the demand in our family support services. And that demand hasn't necessarily been met with a rise in capacity because of funding constraints. So in terms of recovery, that's certainly something I would think about in terms of Scottish Government and where they might want to direct some of the funding.
I think that's very helpful. We are, of course, experiencing, if you like, a second wave or a second spike, certainly, in COVID-19. And it's trying to gauge how we identify the need out there and where the unmet demand is. So I represent Glasgow, Maryhill and Springford. And one of the things that politicians do from time to time is put out parliamentary reports. The front page of my parliamentary report was all the advice lines that are out there to support people, including the National Assistance Helpline, to make sure people can get food. Now, one of the local organisations I've started to speak to, some have contacted me and said they've had a bit of a spike in requests for food need help, support and assistance. So that's why I wanted to make sure, and they're fantastic organisations, I wanted to make sure that the unmet needs being identified and met, which made me think about the Third Sector Community Recovery Programme and those funds. And I'm just wondering if community organisations now see a spike in a demand for food need and other supports, what funds are currently open to allow them to apply to those funds to try and quickly get cash in to meet that increasing demand, which is happening in real time now. So I know Sally Dyson wanted to come in and make an additional comment anyway, but Sally, could you maybe make an additional comment and maybe reflect on the points that I've made as well, Sally?
Absolutely, thank you. It's those comments that I did want to reflect on, because as part of the learning from the Wellbeing Fund and from talking to other funders, we wanted to make sure that something was baked in the beginning of the Recovery Fund programme that would enable flexibility. And so whilst organisations had to and has to give an indication of what they want to do with that money, what's baked into the parameters of that is if we see a spike, if we go into a deeper lockdown or come out of a bit of lockdown, that actually organisations can flex and they can use that money to meet the needs that they see in front of them. So I think that's really good that was a consideration right from the beginning, that this was going to be, you know, a fluid situation. It could be that we, you know, may need to request some more money from Scottish Government, depending on how long this goes on for. But really embracing those principles of organisations' need to know that they have some money to be able to do what they see in front of them, really important and really brilliant that was part and that was agreed.
So can I just check, Sally Dyson, what advice would you give? Maybe we'll contact you after the meeting, Sally, I don't know, but what advice would you give local MSPs, if you like, who try to reach out, identify where that need is, and then of course, you identify the need, you direct them to local volunteer and first sector organisations, and it puts increased demand and pressure on them, as fantastic as they are. And a lot of the monies they had applied for, including the Wellbeing Fund and the Food Fund and other things, they kind of petered out around September, October. And we're, of course, now in November. So for that second spike in demand, what live funds are available to allow the first sector to apply to?
So the live funds from Scottish Government that I'm aware of are the the Communities Recovery Fund and Adapt and Thrive. And both of those funds that were open from late September, early October, I can't quite remember the date. So funds have been going out continually. Point them towards SCVO's Funding Scotland, where that's available. It's a very simple application form. But also the messages that we're getting from our talking to, you know, independent funders such as National Lottery, Cora Foundation. If an organisation already has a relationship with a funder, talk to them about what you're seeing. That was a really key message that was coming across. Talk to your funder first, because it's likely that they will be able to flex and adapt But those community recovery funds are open, and it's a really pretty quick turnaround time. We're talking about 3 weeks from application, and there's lots of help and advice and support there for organisations if they need it.
Sally Dyson, that reassures me, and I should point out, I think in my local organisation are very well clocked into those networks and well supported. One brief comment from myself, and I'll bring Martin Canavan in, and then we'll move on to the next line of questioning. But my experience in Mary Ellen Springburn has been is the third sector organisations are working very closely together, so there's not different organisations competing for these funds, but they're actually getting together and they're putting in one bid and then sharing the resources appropriately across quite large areas to make sure those in greatest need get it. And that's been a success story. And I'm assuming and hoping that has happened rather broadly elsewhere. So I wanted to put that on the record. Martin Canavan, do you have any additional comments? And then I'll go to Tom Arthur after this.
Certainly, it was just to follow up and, you know, what advice would you perhaps give to colleagues, MSPs and others? First of all, I would say Aberlour has an urgent assistance fund, as I've mentioned, and might speak about that in a bit more detail. And, you know, whenever people can support families to apply to that, we are always willing and hopefully able to help, certainly in the crisis, immediate sense to support families. I think obviously the Scottish Welfare Fund is one obvious way in which families should be able to get support. I think that's probably something we'll talk about in a little bit more detail. But one of the things that the Scottish Welfare Fund, I think, that does require to be addressed is the wider knowledge and awareness of the Scottish Welfare Fund. So I'm just taking this opportunity to do a little bit of that if I can.
I think that will absolutely come up, if not in this panel, I certainly will definitely come up in the next panel when we're speaking to some local authority colleagues as well. Tom Arthur.
Thank you, convener. A lot of the ground I want to explore has, I think, already been covered around de-restricting and flexibility. But I'm keen to hear the views of both Sally and Martin with regards to what the impact has been on the culture and behaviour of third sector organisations and social enterprises due to this increased flexibility. Anecdotally, what I've picked up is that some organisations which felt that the process for applying for funding could be a barrier, I felt that barrier has been reduced or removed entirely, and it's encouraged them to be a bit more bold and ambitious. And indeed, some organisations which hadn't previously got that far have been able to receive funding. And so the way they would have described it to me, it was almost more of an entrepreneurial approach from these funding schemes and almost taking a risk, because there isn't obviously the same time to assess applications. And so it's given organisations a bit of confidence just to effectively go for it. And it's had some very positive results on the ground. And I know that from my work in my own constituency of Renfrewshire South. So I just wonder if anything I'm saying there echoes with any of our panellists. And maybe if we start with Sally.
Well, thank you. I think I would echo everything that you've said there. SCVO were absolutely delighted around the way in which it's a fine balance still between assessing applications and getting that done really quickly. And we've seen organisations come up with some really novel ways of supporting their communities and also working more in collaboration with other local organisations. And that in some respects makes it easier for the assessment of applications because you are seeing fewer applications. I think the funders working together, we've seen that happen much more. Funders, you know, have always worked together. But, you know, what I'd like to say is that Scottish Government and other funders were, you know, coming together collectively fortnightly up until last week, actually, and where they've moved to monthly. And so they're exchanging knowledge about the practices that they have. And so learning really closely and quickly where people have been able to maybe, you know, take a little bit of a step out of the process, being able to do that and really focus hard on getting money quickly out to communities. And the thing that I'm finding really heartening is that ongoing conversation is So how do we keep the momentum on this? How do we make sure that we learn from, you know, the experience that we've been through, and we don't go back to how we did things before? So I'm really heartened that we're starting to see a change in the funding environment for local voluntary sector organisations.
Before I ask Martin, just a question I want to pick up on just what you said there. If you could, I know I'm putting you on the spot here, but if you could maybe distill, say, three key lessons of that we've learned from this experience, things that we need to retain as we go forward around funding for the third sector and social enterprises and voluntary groups.
Three key things. One is definitely around the de-restriction of funding where possible. And we know that's not always possible, but where it is possible to be able to do that. Asking organisations to provide, being really careful about thinking about what information is being asked for by funders and what that's going to be used for, so that you're shortening the application process and you've got that critical information. And collaboration of funders. So with the Wellbeing Fund and all of the other emergency funds, we were able to create a hub. With the Recovery Fund, what we have is a single front door and a single application form for all of those recovery funds. So organisations apply once and that gets seen by a number of funders. Actually moving that further would be brilliant. So those are the three things: restriction, as many funders working together as possible, and taking those steps out where they can.
Thank you, Sally. Could I pose these questions to Martin as well? Maybe just first, generally, what his reflections are on the implications of having a more de-restricted and flexible environment, and whether that's encouraged innovation and allowed some organisations to get to develop in a way they wouldn't have been able to otherwise. And perhaps if you would want to summarise, he has three key lessons that he's learned from this experience.
On your first point, and I can only speak from Avalor's point of view here, but I think one of the things I would say about the response over the last 6 months is that it's just naturally the third sector, I think, because of the way it operates and the way it's structured, organisations are structured naturally more flexible and agile, which has allowed them, ourselves included, to be able to work. Allowed us to work in a way that's been able to respond more flexibly to the need, in a way that local authorities, just because of their size and structure, but won't always be able to do. And I think just being able to recognise that we're doing the right thing, you know, having that permission to be able to respond to the need that we're seeing in the way that we feel is best, and the flexibility that's been allowed through funding to be able to do for us to be able to do that has been very, very positive. So I would echo Sally's comments in that regard. On the point of your second point there about three things, I don't know that I would be able to identify anything further to what Sally has said.
Okay, thank you, Martin.
Okay, Tom, do you have another question?
So I just see Sally has an R in the chat bar, convener.
Oh, you're more eagle-eyed than I am. My apologies, Sally. Sally Dyson.
That's okay, thank you. I think just one final thing that I wanted to say, which is listening to organisations. SCVO has a history with working with thousands of organisations. And some of this flexibility they've been asking for a long, long time. So being able to demonstrate through you know, the last 6 months, just how fleet of foot they can be. And I think trust has really increased over the last 6-8 months between organisations and between funders and organisations. And that's really blossomed, and I think we need to cherish and take that forward. So this has allowed organisations to do what they've been saying they can do for a long, long time and really demonstrate it.
Yeah, I agree entirely, Sarah. That has been very much my experience with organisations a long time ago. That was very helpful, and thank you very much. No further questions, convener.
Thanks, Tom. Shona Robinson.
Good morning, everyone. I wanted just to focus my line of questioning on the issue of individual need, and to ask both Martin and Sally about the level of individual need that your organisations and other third sector organisations identified during COVID, and what that perhaps tells us about any of the weaknesses in the social security safety net system, and to paraphrasing there, and importantly, how those weaknesses might be addressed and lessons learned. Maybe come to Sally first.
Thanks, Shauna. So SDVO funds organisations who then support individuals, and as I've been saying in the first, up until now really, it's been about getting money out, and we're now just starting to get all of the, you know, sort of really rich information in from organisations about who they've supported and how. So we expect to be able to start to see and to share that information within the next couple of months.
That would be really helpful, Sally. And will that identify the interface between the individuals and families of face between, you know, the social security system and support and help that they've required to get from the organisations that have been funded locally? Will it have that granular detail, do you think?
So we will definitely have some case studies of that granular detail about individuals and families. And we'll also have, you know, some of the greater statistics around, you know, sort of clusters of people that were supported in, you know, which communities, you know, what and with what and what worked there. So we'll have both of those things, so that we'll always be backed up by some really great stories, because we know that organisations love telling us those stories and sharing them, because that's the way it reaches us all really well.
I think that would be great information to share with the committee once that's available, Sally, if that's okay. Martin, can I ask you the same question?
Certainly. I think the short answer to your question is that the level of need has been overwhelming and stark in many, many cases in terms of the families and the communities. We actually have just undertaken, or Heriot Watt University, I should say, have undertaken an analysis of the first 6 months of the use of our Urgent Assistance Fund over the period of the pandemic. And I think that's due to be published next week, I believe, but I would be more than happy to give early sight of that to the committee and share that after the session this morning. But I can talk to some of the top kind of line information and what we have been able to identify over the last 6 months. The impact on our Urgent Assistance Fund, for example, we've seen around a 1,400% rise in applications to the fund compared to any other time in previous years. That equates to somewhere in the region of more than 2,000 families in the first 6 months that we've been able to reach, about 4,500 children. And what you can probably imagine is that's families who are in desperate situations and circumstances, who are in crisis and have really nowhere else to turn. Families who were struggling and to make ends meet pre-pandemic, who have fallen further, been pushed further or deeper into poverty. That's families where one or both parents have perhaps been furloughed or actually not lost their jobs, been self-employed as a result of the pandemic. Families who may be in those circumstances and are now applying for universal credit, but in that 5 week wait period and have no savings or income to draw on in that period. And so we have seen just an incredible you know, illustration of what that level of need looks like, the scale of that, I should say. And actually, to get into the detail of what that looks like, I mean, the vast majority of the funds, the grants that we provide to families, which on average are about £240 per family, is to help with food. I think 60% of the applications that come into our fund are looking for help and assistance with food preparation, provision, storage, prepaid power cards and fuel to help pay for that, beds, bedding, children's clothing, white goods. And I think what's become quite apparent to us is that the level of need is alarming. And what we see is probably akin to something that would be more recognisable as absolute rather than relative poverty, the circumstances that families are finding themselves in. So it's absolutely desperate, and it has been quite overwhelming, as I say.
Martin, just to, for clarity, you seem to be saying that there's been particularly two groups affected. One are those who were already struggling pre-pandemic and whose levels of poverty have been severely exacerbated. But there's another group of people as well who may be coming into contact with the social security system for the first time and have maybe never been in contact with it, which will then bring them up against, as you've described, the 5-week wait for universal credit. Is that a fair summation of what you're saying?
That is. And as I say, you know, we've got an analysis that we'll be able to share, and that will give you more of a kind of breakdown in terms of kind of demographic and be able to give you more fixed kind of data around that. But that's certainly the picture that we've seen. You know, the groups that we already know that were struggling beforehand, types of families and communities are identified in the Scottish Government's own Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. You know, they are in even more desperate circumstances and situations now, but then there's those that probably would have described themselves as being comfortable, you know, in advance of the pandemic, who have now found themselves in circumstances where they've had to come to Aberlour or other organisations that have hardship funds to get the help they need. I suppose one of the other things, and this kind of referring back to the Scottish Welfare Fund, which I mentioned earlier, in terms of how the safety net might not actually be working the way it's supposed to be, we found that about 10% of the families who are applying to our fund are volunteering that in their applications that they have unsuccessfully applied to the Scottish Welfare Fund in advance of coming to looking for help from Aberlour. And I think that's also quite concerning. Because of the scale of our fund, it's not something that we would never necessarily have seen or been able to identify as a particular challenge or an issue in advance of the pandemic. But because of the sheer rise in the number of applications we're seeing, it's become quite a concern. And on the face of it, the reasons that are given for families who are applying, you know, the circumstances that they're identifying and the things that they really require help and support with urgently, are those issues that you would expect the Scottish Welfare Fund to be able to support them with. You know, they would be able to go to the Scottish Welfare Fund and access the help and support they need. But in many circumstances, we're finding that that's simply not the case. In some authorities, we're finding things like community care grants have been suspended, for example, or closed reportedly. And therefore families maybe haven't been able to get some of the help for things like white goods and other household items that they might otherwise be able to, or they might be looking for support to be able to get. So yeah, I think in that way we've been able to highlight that there's definitely problems there with the safety net and the Scottish Welfare Fund in particular.
I think the information that you describe that we could get sight of sounds a very rich seam of information, very pertinent to our inquiry. It also sounds, and it would be helpful, I don't know whether this is included in that, but if not, if you were to be able to provide any evidence of that geographical variation of the use of the Scottish Welfare Fund, you know, in terms of whether there are certain authorities that are declining more people, what those reasons are, anything around that would be extremely helpful as well.
Certainly, I think we'll provide whatever information we can. I think the Poverty and Equality Commission have provided quite a good analysis of the use and the distribution of the Scottish Welfare Fund, and we've been able to provide some certainly kind of anecdotal evidence of where the fund might be, there might be challenges in relation to the fund versus where it might be working better. But certainly, any further information that we provide, we'll share with you.
Okay, thank you. That's all from me, convener. Thank you.
I see that Sally Dyson wants to come in. Sally, hold on to your thoughts for a second, because of that bid from Rachel Hamilton. It would need to be a brief supplementary, Rachel, just because of time constraints. But if you want to do your supplementary just now, then Sally can perhaps respond to that and her additional comments.
Thanks, Convener. It will be brief. I just wanted to ask Martin there where he directs families who have been turned down for the Scottish Welfare Fund. You mentioned the Poverty and Inequalities Commission, and they have advised that there should be a right of appeal. I just wondered, what do you do when families are turned down?
Well, it makes sense to Martin first there, obviously, then we'll go to Sally. Martin, yeah.
Well, we provide what help and support we can. That's what our fund is there for, to be a support mechanism for families that really don't have anywhere else to go. And there are some groups who aren't even eligible for the Scottish Welfare Fund, who rely on our fund, like families where there's no recourse to funds, for example. But in those circumstances, we would help. We would provide whatever support we can through cash grants, or if appropriate and possible, we'll also provide the items that they might be looking for but haven't been able to access through the Scottish Welfare Fund. I suppose our efforts in responding to what some of those challenges and issues are in relation to the Scottish Welfare Fund and accessibility and whether or not families can get the help they should be entitled to is by highlighting where we are finding these challenges, making sure that yourselves, the committee, others, Scottish Government, for example, who we've engaged with on this issue as well, just recognise where the weaknesses and the challenges are and do what we can to help and support the Scottish Government and local authorities to try and address some of those challenges.
Okay. Sally Dyson.
I just wanted to go back to the point around people who would be touching services, social services, for the first time. That was very much something that was at the forefront of volunteering community organisations thinking way back in, sort of March, April, May, in their applications and in their conversations with us, and looking as to how they could identify and place themselves to be visible to people who wouldn't necessarily have realised that they needed support before. So that thinking has already started within lots of organisations, and that change and that adaption is a really clear example of their forward thinking. Thank you.
Okay. Pauline McNeill.
Good morning. So in a lot of the submissions, we've heard that some groups are more severely affected than others, as you might expect. As I say, quote them. This is kind of a common theme, that the crisis disproportionately felt by groups already identified, such as lone parents, PME families, young mothers, families with a disabled adult or child, and families with a child under one. So I wanted to ask the witnesses, would you agree with that, or is there any not mentioned in that list? I would have thought people who've been shielding, for example, who might have lost a job through shielding, might be included in that group, for example. So I would be keen to know if there's anyone we've missed out of that group.
Sally Dyson, do you want to? Oh, Martin, even better. Martin Canavan, yes, please.
Yes. So I think the groups that you've outlined and that others have highlighted who have been most affected is probably consistent with what we have found ourselves, again coming back to the Urgent Assistance Fund, our own Urgent Assistance Fund. We have found the same, I think 70%, around 70% of applications to Urgent Assistance Fund and families that we've supported have been single parent households. That's quite strongly reflected. Beyond that, Black and minority ethnic communities and families are overrepresented in terms of our fund and applications to our fund. Asylum seeking families and families with no recourse to public funds are also significant in terms of the numbers of families proportionately that we're seeing applying. And also families where there's families who are living with a disability, either a parental disability or child's disability are have been significantly impacted. And so I would say that they are broadly the groups that we've got experience in relation to our experience who have been most affected by the pandemic and the financial impact.
Sally Dyson.
completely agree with everything that everyone said. I've got nothing to add to that, no further insight.
Thanks, Sally.
And perhaps, Sally, you might want to comment the importance of the digital connection, particularly amongst those groups, because many public services can now only be accessed by using the internet. And I just wondered if you wanted to comment on that. I mean, I also have a concern as well that perhaps too much, there always was too much reliance on this and a removal of face-to-face, and that's something this committee has tackled over the social security vision, and we managed to establish that our agency will, unlike the DWP, have more face-to-face. Do you have any concerns that we might move away from this as we pass the COVID period? And anything you want to say about digital connection, I think would be really important. Thank you.
Thank you. And this has shown us just how important it is for people to be able to connect digitally. An SDVO have quite a history with working with Scottish Government on that around the Digital Participation Charter. And we were delighted, absolutely delighted, that we were going from talking to people about how important digital is as part of connecting and communicating, but not absolutely not the whole of it, and that there has to be a choice there for people. And so Connecting Scotland, we were absolutely delighted to go from that persuading people that they need to consider it to being able to respond really quickly. Agree entirely, it isn't and should never be about just having the digital connectivity. Phones are fantastic too. Just having that conversation with somebody on the phone, but it is part of the mix. Helping people to get online and to work out what they want to use online connectivity for and to have that choice is really important.
Martin, you want to come in?
I think to mirror or echo what Sally has said there about the importance of digital connectivity. I think one of the things we discovered or became apparent, I should say, very, very early on was just how pervasive digital exclusion is as an issue for so many families. The families that we work with, for example, struggling families who don't have access, who don't have devices, or if they do, they don't have access to broadband or data. And I think it was probably an inequality that clearly existed previously, but because of the way in which we all moved indoors and started using our phones and our laptops to communicate, it became quite apparent that there was a huge section of society, children, families and communities simply didn't have that access. We have done what we could. Working alongside the Scottish Government, Children First as well, we worked alongside them through the Connecting Scotland Fund to be able to access and distribute devices, laptops, and get them out to families that we knew didn't have access to devices or to data or to top up data packages for them. And that was really, really important. It was important for a whole number of reasons. First of all, there was just being able to keep connected, families connected, us connected to families and families connected to our services that would rely on our family support services, for example, and the support that we provide. We moved almost overnight to wholesale, to almost kind of virtual and digital support in the initial period after lockdown. And so it was vital that we could make sure families were connected. So we did what we could to make sure families had devices and data so that we could do that. Obviously, for children's education, it was absolutely crucial and key. And just the wider connection to families, social connections to communities, to friends, and recognising the impact that the lack of that would have or does have on children and families' well-being and mental health. So it's clearly been an issue. I think it's been addressed in some regards. The Scottish Government have obviously committed to doing what they can, but I think we need to look at it much more closely as an issue and recognise that digital connection no longer a luxury. It's absolutely crucial and essential for families, all families, to live, function, to be connected to their communities and to be able to access all the services they need, including social security and welfare.
Sally Dyson.
I just want to come back on that and echo everything that Martin said, but really raise that Scottish Government has been working on this agenda really consistently for a number of years, and that was a fantastic platform to operate from. And I know, speaking to colleagues in other nations, they're actually really jealous of the position that we were able to move from. And Just Connecting Scotland, you know, in the first phase, which was £5 million, it reached over 8,500 people with devices and connectivity, you know, in May and June of this year, and helped them to, as Martin says, both keep in touch, you know, with friends, family, neighbours, but also access the services of organisations, because as Martin points out, overnight, lots of charities and voluntary organisations immediately went to look at how they could deliver remotely. And then in the second phase of Connecting Scotland, there's been a further 17,000 people reached. And this isn't just with a device. This is with a device, but also linked to somebody that usually is known, so that they're a digital champion, that they're helped and supported, and their confidence developed to go online. In particular, we know that one of the biggest barriers to people getting online is that they don't feel safe there. And we know that there's been an increase in all sorts of scams over this period of time. So having that digital champion, that known, trusted person who's there to help somebody through that, is absolutely critical. And more often than not, helping them to get online has been about something that they enjoy, whether it's just having a blether, whether it's about a hobby or an interest. And that leads to confidence around some of the other things that they need to engage with, and making sure that people know that it is that choice. And that's really critical. And that's a key message that I would really want the panel and everybody to take away from that. This is about choice for people.
Polly McNeill.
Move on, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Keith Brown, to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Keith Brown, I know Keith's been having some issues accessing just now. We'll give him a couple of seconds. Oh, Keith, can you hear us?
It's working fine for me, but it's working fine for me just now, convener, although for some reason the mute button keeps going on and off. So apologies if this cuts out again. My question, which kind of touches on some issues which have already been raised, relates to the point I think that Sally made previously about the flex that she has been willing and keen to see being used by organisations that are receiving funding. I just wonder, though, in relation to her role and also the role of organisations like hers, whether they've also used that flex. I'm conscious that in my area we have some groups who very quickly had lots of resources sent their way. I can think of one that's got a community larder, which is one of the, even now, one of the best stock larders anywhere. Certainly tons of volunteers coming forward, and not the same level as need as, say, for example, to the food banks in my constituency. So it's really to understand how SCVO and others managed to flex the way that they were allocating funding to make sure it went to those most in need over the course of the last few months.
Sally, do you want to
go? Yes, sure. Thank you. So very much listening to organisations and asking the question about what they're linking into locally have been critical for us to be able to get money and activity and support to where it really needs to be. And I think one of the things that we have seen coming through from lots of applications from organisations is about how they are linking and networking, but also about how they're thinking about the different types of support that they can give. So whilst, you know, they maybe have been focusing around one particular activity and having knowledge of the people, you know, that they are supporting, you know, being able to put in, you know, some additional support into that so that they're becoming more multifaceted.
Martin?
No, I think I'm okay. Thanks.
Oh, okay, thank you. He's fine.
Yeah, I suppose my point is that in relation to not being as perhaps as stringent or as onerous in terms of financial accountability as we would in normal circumstances, the government will want to make sure the money is going to those most in need. And I just wonder whether either have got any.
I'm not sure if other people are having the same IT issues as myself there. I see some nodding heads. Yes.
I think it was my side, convener.
Okay, do you want to continue, Keith? We can hear you if we can't, yeah. If we can't see you. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's on my side. I think after I finish this, I'll log out and try and relocate and see if I can log back on. It was just the idea about, you know, financial accountability is very important, but obviously that's been more lax, quite rightly, during this pandemic. But we still want to make sure the money's going to the those most in need. And I just wonder if there's any examples that can be given by either of the panellists as to where they've switched priorities or switched from one organisation to another, or taken account of the fact that perhaps one area that's receiving money isn't as effective as another. Are there any examples that you can give?
If I can answer.
Yes, of course.
I think in terms of financial accountability, and I'm going to speak really on from the perspective of Aberlour and the way in which we operate our own fund, and how we direct money and distribute money to families directly. A key element of how we do that is about, it's based on the principle of trust. We don't ask families to be able to provide receipts, for example, in the way other funds or organisations might do in relation to the money that they've received. Families are sponsored by a professional, usually a social worker, you know, a financial inclusion officer, someone like that, teacher perhaps, they submit an application and they outline their needs, and on the basis of that, we try and provide them with a suitable grant or in some cases the actual items that they're looking for. But being able to have that trust, and for families to be able to have that sense of trust, and also the dignity and choice that goes along with just having the money being provided to them, that allows them then to spend that money and use that money for things that they themselves decide and choose that they need. I think that's absolutely crucial, and I think that really needs to just be the basis and the principle in which we do support families financially, whether that's through the Scottish Welfare Fund, whether that's through hardship funds, or whatever other way we are supporting families, Scottish Child Payment, for example, and other social security measures. That cash-first approach, that getting money directly into families' pockets and allowing them the trust, the dignity and the choice, that is so crucial. And so I think in terms of financial accountability, yes, obviously we need to apply you know, oversight in the ways to make sure that money is getting to where it needs to get. But at that level, when we're talking about getting it directly to families, then I think we operate on that basis, and we think that's the basis that we should operate as a country, I suppose.
Sally Dyson?
Just to pick up again on the issue of financial probity and due diligence, I can talk about the Wellbeing Fund and SCVO's role in that. And we were, whilst we did make sure that some of the processes were freed up, actually financial due diligence was really still important. but that was in the context of the grants that we were giving out were going to be spent. We were hoping that they would be spent in a maximum of 3 or 4 months. And so weren't asking for, you know, lots of onerous documentation, either at assessment stage or at monitoring stage. It all sounds very process driven when actually what we really need to be getting about is people. But making sure that we were absolutely clear that what we were asking for in reporting was proportionate. And so there was some rigour there, but it was proportionate rigour to what the organisations were doing, and focusing very much on trust. These are established organisations within their communities, whatever type or size, they've been around for a long time and know that the communities that they're working with really well. And so passing that trust down. But there was a, you know, a really good degree of financial probity there.
Keith Brown.
Hey, I don't have another question, convener. I don't know whether this is a correction. That wasn't really a question. I was asking about financial accountability. I was asking about the organisations having allocated funding, using flexibility after that point, if they found that the funding wasn't being as effective, or it could be more effective in another area. But it may be a connectivity issue, and I'll try and take it up separately. But thanks for that, convener.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Thanks, convener. I think a lot of what I wanted to ask has been covered, but I did want to probe a little bit more into the digital inclusion. So do you believe that all local authorities across Scotland have identified those who are most in need of digital support, and are they being referred? And also, do you believe with the reliance on moving to digital without, you know, the physical buildings being available for meetings and one-to-ones, do you think that the Connect Scotland Fund is going far enough, taking into account that we seem to be in a second wave and continuing with this situation? And it's to both witnesses.
Okay. Any volunteers to go first?
Yeah, I'm happy to take first pitch into that. All local authorities and lots of other partners as well are engaged with Connecting Scotland. And it's a really great partnership. And I see those conversations happening on a really regular basis. Is it going far enough? Not yet. But we're on a trajectory for going far enough. Because Connecting Scotland is one element of a whole wider digital inclusion programme that's been delivered through housing associations, through lots of other voluntary and community organisations, through NHS and through a number of private sector organisations as well. So having that multifaceted approach to help people, and you know, it is really critical, and it's been, you know, ongoing for a while. This is a big spearhead around it because the time is right. Everybody could immediately see why we need it, to give people the choice and the ability to be online as well. It's a long road because there are so many different elements to being online, and those are changing really rapidly. You know, we can just see from, you know, the number of video conferencing calls that people seem to be taking place in their everyday lives, whether they're for work or, you know, family quizzes around keeping in touch. I communicate more using digital technology. And brilliant that Connecting Scotland was extended in programme for government, because we need to be able to help people through this situation and integrating, you know, sort of the elements of digital technology that they want in their whatever their lives become like in the future. We need to do more, and we are able to do more at the moment, and we will need to be able to continue to do more.
Martin?
Martin Canavan.
Yeah, I would say that I think it's really, really positive, the work that's been going on, the commitments made by Scottish Government, the aim to reach particularly disadvantaged families and others who are currently not connected. And we support that. I suppose, until everyone in Scotland is connected and has access, then no scheme has gone far enough. We have seen over the course of the pandemic, as I mentioned earlier on, you know, the issue of digital exclusion being kind of highlighted and magnified as a result of the pandemic and lockdown. And we have been having to provide and support families to get access to devices to support them with data and with connectivity. So where we are having to do that, obviously means that the local authorities and others aren't necessarily. We've also seen locally in areas we work with, there's schools in one local authority where all pupils have been provided with iPads or other devices, yet in some schools pupils aren't. So clearly it's not reaching everyone. And more needs to be done, but I think there's some good progress has been made so far. I think we need to think more about the kind of circumstances for families as well. Specifically, it isn't just about giving every family an iPad or giving every family a laptop. If you're in a family, families who maybe, you know, 2, 3, 4 children who are all school age, then they all effectively need their own device if they want to have access and be able to be connected to their school, to education. Mum, dads, whoever, parents also need their own device, or be a smartphone, a laptop, whatever it might be. So it's recognising what the individual circumstances are for families and making sure that when we say families are connected, that just doesn't mean a laptop that the family have to share, but it's actually making sure that we're responding to the particular needs, digital needs of what those families are. And I think, you know, Sally was talking about digital champions earlier on, and I think, yeah, that's something else that needs to be looked at further, because we support many vulnerable families and many vulnerable parents. We work with families where one or both parents have a learning disability, and for families in those circumstances, you know, they are often unable the levels of digital literacy, I should say, are maybe not great. And so there requires a lot of actual support to go in there to support the families to be able to use the devices, to be able to access the systems that they may be required to. So it's not just about making sure every family, every household has a device. It's about recognising what the circumstances are for individual families. And I think that's what the government, local authorities and others have to look at and have to recognise if we're going to reach everyone and make sure we don't have any level of digital exclusion at all.
Yeah, and thank you, Convener. Coming back to Martin's point there, obviously a lot of daycare services haven't resumed within the various local authority settings. And I just wondered whether you felt that the voices of people with learning disabilities and indeed disabled people are being heard, because I'm getting a lot of feedback from families and unpaid carers who want to get back to those settings. And I really want to dig deep into, you know, how that has an effect on the service that you are offering, if local authorities perhaps would be beneficial for them to be able to get the physical and human contact face-to-face services going, because obviously the buildings aren't appropriate. So would you sort of support that call? Martin?
So I can certainly say that the experience of the families we work with parents who have a learning disability, is that the experience of social isolation and the lack of contact they have had with the services that support them, the formal contact, but also the more informal contact amongst their communities, has been felt very, very acutely. We have done what we can across all of our services to be able to make sure families are connected and have a level of contact to be able to provide some form of support. But that lack of personal connection, that lack of physical connection, has really been felt. It's been felt, you know, by families all right across Scotland that we work with, but I think it would be fair to say that it's been specifically and acutely felt by families where parents have a learning disability because of the networks in which they would normally rely for the support, informal and formal networks. And anything that would allow us to get back to a point where some of that support that they would have expected and received pre-pandemic can happen would be really, really positive. But obviously that's within the context of what is safe and what the regulations tell us. But nonetheless, yeah, it's hurt. It's affected some groups, obviously more than others.
Dali, you want to add anything?
I think it's just a real opportunity for us to do a reimagining of services so that we have the blended elements of, you know, face-to-face, formal and informal, where it's safe and relevant, and backing that up with, you know, different types of services online and delivered digitally. What we would really hate, and we do this a lot through service design with local organisations, is if you're looking at delivering something digitally, this isn't just delivering what you deliver physically and changing that, you know, directly onto a digital delivery. It's really thinking through carefully about what can be delivered and putting people at the heart of that. And obviously, face-to-face for everybody is a critical part of that.
Rachel, any final questions before we move on?
No, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Rachel. Shona Robinson.
Thanks, Convener. Just really to ask both of you if there is anything else you want to put on the record regarding the Third Sector and Communities Recovery Programme in the context of second wave of COVID that's not been said already. And secondly, just, you know, we've touched on this already about the response to COVID in terms of how organisations have been working together, particularly the third sector, local authority and social security. We've highlighted some of the weaknesses. If both of you could perhaps say what you think perhaps could be done in the short term to better complement those organisations' grants and financial support in a way that makes it easier for the end user to access. Obviously, long term, you've talked about reimagining services, but that's going to take time. But in the here and now, is there anything that could be done that could improve that those organisations and the financial support that they offer, complementing each other a bit better than they do at the moment? Maybe come to Martin first.
Certainly. So in terms of the Scottish Welfare Fund, which I've obviously touched on a couple of times this morning, we have a number of recommendations. We've done a little bit of work with some other organisations, One Parent Family Scotland and Child Poverty Action Group, where we've identified what some of the weaknesses I've already kind of highlighted and spoken about are in relation to the Welfare Fund and how it supports families, or maybe in some of the ways it hasn't been able to support families. And so we have some recommendations about how that could be strengthened and improved. I mentioned earlier on about community care grants having been suspended, reportedly closed or suspended over the course of the pandemic. And one of the things we'd obviously like to see is to make sure that that doesn't happen, that form of grant remains open and available to families who require it. The application process itself has been reportedly highlighted as convoluted and complicated for people, and it's inconsistent from authority to authority. Making sure, you know, the information that's required is there in easy read form. It isn't solely available digitally or only through telephone applications, but a range of ways in which families and others can apply to the funds need to be made available. And that needs to be consistent. The guidance, I think, the Scottish Government guidance on the fund and how the fund operates for local authorities could certainly be strengthened to improve consistency of the management of the fund, consistency of decision-making processes. And crucially, and I think this is something that we've been quite shocked by in relation to our own urgent assistance fund, is just how little knowledge or awareness there is of the Scottish Welfare Fund nationally, not just amongst families or communities that should be able to access and be eligible and to be able to receive support from the fund, but actually amongst practitioners and professionals and the sort of people that support families to apply to our own fund, there is often very little knowledge, if any, of the Scottish Welfare Fund. Just to come back to the point I made earlier on about a report and analysis of our Urgent Assistance Fund, I think it's really important to recognise that around 40% of the applications that come into our fund are sponsored by local authority workers. That's either a combination of local authority staff or by education staff. Yet the level of knowledge and awareness of Scottish Welfare Fund is quite limited. So I think that speaks volumes to just how little information or knowledge or awareness there is. So I think a lot of work needs to happen by the Scottish Government and from local authorities to provide that public information, to raise awareness and to promote the fund so that people know it's there and people know they can access it when they need to. And it should be somewhere where they think of first when they're at that point that they need urgent and immediate help.
Thanks for that. Sally, anything to add?
I agree with everything that Martin said, and I'm just going to kind of take it up a little level. Continue to trust and push trust as far as you possibly can. Service design and reimagining services doesn't have to be something that's long term. It's that little and often. Collaborate more, talk maybe for shorter amounts of time, but really regularly. And always remember to have the service users, you know, at the heart of the conversations that you're having around, you know, whatever it is that affects them. Listen and listen really well and share ideas and change things. And I think everybody should be pushing themselves. If you're not feeling a little bit uncomfortable about what you're doing, then I don't think you're necessarily pushing far enough to make things better for people that we're working with.
Okay, thanks. That's really helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. And just before we close this evidence session, I'm sure this will come up in the next evidence session as well. During our response to COVID, there's been the on-the-ground, if you like, boots-on-the-ground response where people are coming from doorsteps, delivering food supplies, you know, apps and craft for kids. Now we're providing goods and food for people, very volunteer-led donations coming in. We've heard already in this evidence session about where possible, giving cash is much more dignified. I'm aware lots of people, including Aberlour, are giving out store cards for supermarkets or, you know, energy cards, that kind of thing. Is there any brief comments to make about the balance that we should see between the provision of goods and services, if you like, the provision of that idea of like credited cards to go out and buy goods from shops yourself, hard cash, and then the formal social security system? Because what we're effectively talking about is an informal social security system to support, if you like, the weaknesses in the formal system during COVID-19. I know that's got a large question to ask at the end, but if there's any brief thoughts on that at all, I'd appreciate that from witnesses. If not, you could write to us. Does anyone want to make a comment on that? Martin Canavan?
Yeah, I would just simply say, Convener, that we would absolutely support a cash-first approach in any circumstance. I think that we would suggest and propose that that should be the default, regardless of whether we're talking about the informal social security system, welfare system in relation to Scottish Welfare Fund or other measures, or the formal welfare system, social security payments, whatever they may look like. Getting money directly into the pockets of families that allows families to increase their income, have adequate income, household budgets, and allows them the opportunity to have dignity, choice, and trust in terms of how they use that money is absolutely crucial. I think that should always be our default. There's always a place to provide items where necessary, to provide forms of cards, if for one reason or another, cash simply isn't appropriate. But I think we should have a system, a social security system in Scotland that is built on the fundamental principle that we aim to increase family incomes by getting money directly in their pockets. And I think we would always support that as our default approach right across Scotland.
Okay, thank you. And just briefly, Sally Dyson, do you agree with that?
Absolutely. I've got nothing to add to that. Brilliant, okay. Martin.
All right, that's very helpful. It's been a long evidence session this morning. I appreciate your time. Can I thank Sally Dyson and Martin Canavan for your time this morning. We'll now suspend briefly before we go to our next panel of witnesses. Thank you. Okay, and welcome back to our evidence session, agenda item 2. We move to our second panel of witnesses, and can I now welcome Richard Gass, Chair, Rights Advice Scotland, Sheila McCandy, Head of Revenue and Business Support, Highland Council, and Paula Doherty, Benefits and Welfare Team Leader, Dumfries and Galloway Council. Thank you all three of you for supporting our evidence session this morning. And we'll move to our first line of questioning, and that is Rachel Hamilton.
Convener, could you just give me a minute and go to the next person, please?
We certainly can. Sheila Robinson, MSP.
Thanks, Convener. You might have heard the last session. Good morning, everyone, I should have said, first of all. You might have picked up in the last session a fair amount of discussion around the Scottish Welfare Fund, and I want to focus in on that. And just to ask the panel how effectively the Scottish Welfare Fund, in your opinion, has acted as a safety net for those requiring support that they can't get elsewhere. Just to get your initial responses to some of the criticisms, I guess you could say, of the variation of decision making around the Scottish Welfare Fund, and whether you think that that is okay, or whether you think that needs to be standardised, maybe particularly to the local authority colleagues around that, and the call for the Scottish Government guidance to be strengthened, just your view on that. So maybe I'll maybe come to Sheila first.
You're on mute at the moment, Sheila. Broadcasting a chance to get to you. There we go, I think that might be you now. Oh. No, sorry Sheila, I'm not hearing you. I'm not sure if other members can.
Do we go to Paula first then? And
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Hi, everybody. Morning. Thanks for the chance to speak. Scottish Welfare Fund has been essential in supporting customers who are most in need throughout the pandemic. We noticed a significant increase in applications for crisis grants and managed to resolve them locally within timescales to ensure that customers received funding that they desperately required. Community care grant applications at the beginning of the pandemic dropped because, of course, people weren't moving home. And that was a significant reason for people to move from to require community care grant support. After that, the tenancy market opened up again. Our applications for community care grants significantly increased. And at this moment in time, we are at the end of quarter two, we're showing a 20% increase on applications from previous years and an increase in the spend, significant increase in the average spend to clearly show that we are supporting customers with Scottish Welfare Fund at a significantly increased level because of COVID.
Thanks. Paula, what about some of the issues that have been raised about the differing, I mean, I know you maybe can only speak for Dumfries and Galloway, but obviously issues have been raised about inconsistency around decision making and also about this issue about the lack of knowledge and awareness of staff who would be key in supporting applications to the Scottish Welfare Fund. Anything you want to respond to on that?
Yes. We obviously do an awful lot of work locally to ensure awareness of the fund throughout council staff, throughout the schools network, throughout all of our partners, to ensure that customers are well aware of the fund. The consistency in decision making, I can only talk for Dumfries and Galloway. We apply the framework there to ensure that we are supporting customers at most need. And I think, you know, our default position is award. You know, and only not award if we really can't do so. Our spend and success rate of applications shows that we are still receiving, obviously, applications that are unsuccessful. However, that is constantly under review to ensure that we are targeting support and encouraging applications from customers who are possibly weren't aware of the fund in the past. Somebody earlier mentioned around awareness of the fund, and I did some analysis around first applications to the fund and people who apply only once. Because obviously what we see is there's customers who have a community care grant this year and then they come back again next year. And so it's clear that they're already aware of the fund. In March and April this year, as I've turned my paper over the other way, in March we received 803 applications for a crisis grant, of which 450 of them were for customers who had never accessed the fund before and have not accessed the fund since. That was a similar position again in April, where we had 893 applications to the fund, and 409 of these were from customers who had never applied before and never applied since. So that was obviously at the peak of the pandemic. Those numbers of new applications did significantly rise over March and April, and I think that was mainly due to our publicity campaign and the support that we were pushing out to customers. Come to us, we will help, you know, and if we can't help, which was a rare situation, then we would do onward referral or onward signposting to other organisations.
Okay, thanks, Paula. Can we go back to Sheila?
Oh, I don't think we can yet. Should we take Richard Gass, maybe Shona, Sheila, if she can hear us, she might want to log off and log back on again, perhaps. Richard?
Okay. Hopefully you're hearing me fine. Yeah, although I'm Chair of Rights Advice Scotland, I do work for Glasgow City Council, so I can give you a wee bit of information about Glasgow, which largely matches what Paul was saying for Dumfries and Galloway. Our community care grants at lockdown, they completely went through the floor. Folk weren't moving, support services perhaps weren't also supporting folk to make applications for individual items, but that has subsequently changed. And with folk now getting access to tenancies and moving, we've seen a big increase in community care grants. And because it's moving addresses, they're the large community care grants. Folk are requiring not just a single item, but multiple items. A lockdown crisis grants, they went up dramatically, and we had to draft in additional staff. There were 5 additional staff came in from social, and a further 5 came in from elsewhere in revenues and benefits to support what would ordinarily be a 30 members of staff within Scottish Welfare Fund. And things that we were seeing was that people were overspending because of the circumstances being different. Folk were bulk buying, folk were having higher utility costs because we were at home all the time, folk were doing things like buying takeaway food because just maybe not feeling safe and secure to go out to the supermarkets. The folks' expenses went up, and it was the crisis grants that were the safety net. Glasgow, over the last couple of years or 3 years or so, has had a reduction in its Scottish Welfare Fund allocation. Glasgow City Council does put about £1 million into the budget itself, and the additional money that's been made available this year for COVID has certainly been welcome. And although there was a downturn in applications for crisis grants, having spoken to our Revs and Ben section, they are fairly confident that by the end of the financial year, we'll be in a position of having spent every penny to which we've been given, and perhaps more. But something to say about isolation payments, but that might come up probably later on.
The self-isolation support grant. That's fine. Go ahead if you think.
Okay.
Because it's really through the welfare fund, isn't it? Yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
We found that, yes, the idea that there needs to be something additional within the system for folk who are isolating was very important. However, our experience is that there's an awful lot of time and effort being put into place to process claims that are unsuccessful. Glasgow, in the first week, got 250 claims in, of which we only awarded 8. Second week, 200 applications, of which we only awarded 18. On average now, over the last 2 weeks, we've been awarding 25% of the applications, stabilised around about the 250 applications a month. A week, but that shows that we're turning down 3/4 of the applications, and folk are getting turned down because they're not in receipt of a qualifying benefit, and either there's been a lack of information going out to people to make them aware that they need to have the qualifying benefit, or folk believe that they're in a low-income situation, but then find that our assessment for low-income is, do you receive a DWP, means-tested benefit. We don't include the council tax reduction, and there'll be many person who gets council tax reduction but doesn't get a DWP benefit. That's an area that could be examined. Also, there's some people who don't qualify for universal credit. Maybe their income's dropped, they could now go on to universal credit, but for barriers like students. Students are excluded from universal credit. We've got people from abroad who might have no recourse to public funds. They're excluded, although I do appreciate there's maybe some changes coming in the guidance. But some folk who do have recourse to public funds, when they apply for universal credit, what we've found is those applications go into the slow queue. There's probably extra checks to be made to see if someone's going to qualify. And as a consequence, some folk from abroad do not get a quick decision on the universal credit. Probably we need to have some examination as to the definition of low income, because there's a lot of time and effort being put in to make this just to turn folk down, and it's lose, lose, lose. The individual's disappointed. They feel they've been turned down for something to which they felt they were entitled.
So you're recommending a review of the criteria for the self-isolation support grant, and particularly the link to the qualifying benefits. Is that what you're recommending?
Yes. Recommend that. Also, there's been some situations where folk have isolating, but they're not on the list that's been provided to the council. And we know that folk who have been advised to isolate through the app there's problems there. So there needs to be some connectivity behind the scenes in relation to when folk are told to isolate, that the lists that come to local authorities are completely incorrect.
Okay. Just briefly, Richard, do you think COVID has led to us needing to review the Scottish Welfare Fund more generally? Obviously, COSLA have said that, you know, the fund has advanced beyond its original purpose and vision. Do you think there's a need to, more widely, to review the purpose of the Scottish Welfare Fund?
I would think so. When we introduced the Scottish Welfare Fund, that was before Social Security Scotland even existed. This was to bridge a gap for something that the UK government was passing over. However, with devolution of other benefits, there's possibly there should at least be a connectivity between the role of the Scottish Welfare Fund and other Scottish benefits. It is a cash limited budget, which makes it difficult for local authorities to go out there and advertise, hey, we've got this budget, come and claim, because most councils will be spending it to the hilt. So if there's to be an expansion of or a promotion of entitlement, then that needs to be matched with resources to deliver. I think that would then require a whole-scale review of it. And we do have other discretionary schemes. We've got discretionary housing payments. Should they be sitting as something completely separate from the Scottish Welfare Fund? I think perhaps what local authorities deliver maybe needs to be reviewed in its totality.
Okay, that's helpful, Richard. Thank you.
Okay, Rachel Hamilton.
Wanted to pick up on the point about the crisis grants. I just wondered whether witnesses believed that there was an issue with the eligibility and that the criteria should possibly be changed, because we did hear evidence on the 8th of October from Dr. McCormack that, for example, in Glasgow, only 8% of the Scottish welfare budget had been utilised, and it was leaving people without, beds and other goods that they couldn't get access to. So does that speak to a systemic problem within the delivery, which the Poverty Inequalities Commission have highlighted quite a number of issues with that? And also, if the witnesses could expand on some of the comments they've made within their evidence about the criticisms they've made of the Scottish Welfare Fund, please.
Yeah.
I start with...
Sorry, Rachel, Richard? My apologies. I'm really apologies for cutting across here. I just see that Sheila's back online now, and just because Sheila's not had the opportunity to make a comment yet, it might be helpful to start with her. Sorry about that, Rachel.
Okay.
Oh dear, or maybe not. I think you're almost there, Sheila. No, sorry, we better bring other witnesses in. Perhaps Paula Doherty.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to speak. I think when you talk about Scottish Welfare Fund being underspent, then you're looking at both parts of the fund together, and we've already evidenced that community care grant applications and spend levels significantly reduced in the first quarter due to families not moving from one property to another or requiring whole home awards. But crisis grants spend has significantly increased. You know, we've received more applications, and our average award, again, only for Dumfries and Galloway, our average award has increased because more of our customers are on universal credit. There's more families who are accessing the fund, and there's more support being required for a longer period, which is why we are providing more support. For Scottish Welfare Fund, we are able to award or make awards for customers who we define are on a low income, and it's really about resolving their crisis situation. So a customer can be awarded a crisis grant because they've not been paid by their employer, and that's what we found quite significantly at the start of the pandemic. Before furlough was announced, there was panic because obviously employers were indicating that there wasn't any work for staff, and they were facing no paycheck at the end of the week. And then when furlough was announced, some employers took a little bit of time to get those furlough payments out because of their own cash flow issues, and Scottish Welfare Fund was integral in supporting these families during this time. These families may be in receipt of housing benefit, may or may not be in receipt of council tax reduction, but certainly in Dumfries and Galloway, we look at it as the holy trinity of support, council tax reduction, Scottish Welfare Fund and DHP together. And if somebody's getting one, we were making sure to encourage and promote take up of the others. You know, if someone's got a longer term need, a discretionary housing payment may be what they need to support that longer term need because they've got a cash flow issue or a reduction in their income or an increase in their expenditure. Discretionary housing payments are generally awarded for a longer period. So they might get a Scottish Welfare Fund to sort them now and a discretionary housing payment to help them for the next few months. And while we are dealing with that, making sure that we've got their council tax reduction application in recorded and in payment to ensure that their liability to pay council tax is reduced and to meet their income, their available expenditure, their available income. We noted an increase in our council tax reduction caseload throughout this period, and the majority of that increase seems to have been families and families with children, and they are new customers, you know, either haven't been on council tax reduction for some time or have no experience of the welfare system at all. And again, with council tax reduction, we added another benefit into customers who are coming to us for council tax reduction, and we were also looking at free school meals. Free school meals direct payments began in Dumfries and Galloway, I think it was May time. And we made a decision within Dumfries and Galloway that we would also award free school meals direct payments to families who were in receipt of council tax reduction and may not satisfy the Scottish Government criteria for free school meals. So this brought in a whole other raft of children and families who were receiving a direct payment in recompense for school meals, which was an essential financial support to these families. And accounted for, I think, around 20% of our awarded payments.
Okay, thank you. That was really detailed, Paula. Can I bring in Richard?
Yes. I agree with Paula that situation at the start of COVID was community care grants went down, and that was to be expected. But that has now climbed back up. And so I think maybe previous witnesses were commenting on statistics which showed there was a lower spend of community care grants over the period. That wasn't because councils were turning folk down. It was a case of the applications were not coming in. The applications are now coming in and will continue to come in. And all the moves that were on hold are coming through. And I think the proper time to look at it will be at the end of the financial year to see, you know, over the whole period, how did it pan out? Paula also mentioned moving away from Scottish Welfare Fund. She mentioned about school meals. Glasgow did similarly, that they paid money out over the summer. And Glasgow is going to, before Christmas, make payments to cover folk for their school meals for the Christmas break, the February break and the Easter break. So any school holidays between now and the end of the school year will go out in a single lump sum payment to eligible families into bank accounts this side of Christmas. Now, that money being received, albeit it's for school meals, that might then take some pressure off the Scottish Welfare Fund because folk may choose to use that money in the here and now. But what we might find in the future then is that they come back to the Scottish Welfare Fund. The Scottish Welfare Fund is really it's the end of the road. There is nowhere else. And a further factor to be considered is that there was an extra £20 a week put into Universal Credit. That's £80 a month. That's clearly significant. And that has perhaps in some ways protected the Scottish Welfare Fund to an extent. However, when that ends in April of next year, if it's not extended, but it doesn't look like it would be extended, then low-income families will miss £80 a month, and the end of the road is Scottish Welfare Fund. So we anticipate an increase in demand after after the end of this year.
Yeah, I mean, it's something, Richard, that our committee are discussing, which is to support the extension of that uplift in the universal credit. So I just want to, I suppose, round off this by just confirming whether the witnesses believe that there should be a review of the Scottish Welfare Fund and a further monitoring and evaluation as suggested by the Poverty and Equality Commission.
And I'm hoping we can go to Sheila first on this occasion, but let's find out.
Thank you, panel. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi. I do apologise for all the problems. I nipped out to get a headset, so I haven't heard any of the discussion. I do apologise. We certainly feel that the Scottish Welfare Fund hasn't been sufficiently agile to flex to the changing needs that COVID has introduced. And there is a whole wave of individuals who are just sitting above the group of individuals who Scottish Welfare Fund, who was originally intended to support. Of course, the support needs in Scotland now because of COVID have changed. So we would very much welcome a review to enable more people to be entitled, to increase the base of individuals who would be entitled to Scottish Welfare Fund. Because as we know, for every pound we put into the community, that's exponential, isn't it? It's spent many times. So we would certainly support a review of the fund. We very much welcome the refocusing of the uplift in the fund, the second uplift that was held back. We think that's a significant step forward. Very much welcome that. Had it been done a bit earlier, it would have been very helpful, but it's here now, and we think that's going to be really helpful.
Sheila, whilst we've got your voice back, it's nice to hear you. Can you just comment on that, about the further flexibility of the Scottish Welfare Fund that you expressed an interest in the evidence that you gave to the committee?
Yes, so the second tranche of funding, we've been given a lot more powers in terms of how we can use that funding. And we think that's going to really address the local need, and I'm sure all local authorities are exactly the same. It means that more people will be helped at point of need. What the Scottish Welfare Fund does, as Richard referred to, it's the last resort. But as a society, surely we don't want people to have to reach last resort before we can support them as a nation. And we really do think that this repurposing or refocusing, however you want to word it, is doing that. It's catching people before they fall to that lowest level of support that's required. We very much welcome it.
Okay, maybe would other witnesses, if they want to come in on that? Paul Docherty?
Thank you, everybody. I would just like to agree with Sheila's comment around a review of Scottish Welfare Fund would be welcomed. Just if we are looking at expanding eligibility, we need to be aware that that would expand the financial requirements to meet that demand and that need. We're already spending what we have supporting our communities and our customers who are at crisis point. And if we were making a review of that in any way, we would need to make sure that there was additional funding available to help more people. I welcome any discussions around review and any request for case studies and other non-statistical information about how the Scottish Welfare Fund is helping our customers and how they are being supported by that fund and other funds. Thank you.
Okay. Now, just before we allow Richard Gass to address Rachel's question, I've got a couple of others that were specific for Richard Gass as well, and at that point we'll then move on to Paul and Neil for our next theme of questioning. Richard, you mentioned in the evidence session something that was a little bit worrying about local authorities being a bit wary of advertising the Scottish Welfare Fund, because it's almost as if you wanted to pace the grant that were given out from it just in case money ran out. So it would always look, through the course of the year, there were sufficient funds, but it's only sufficient funds if you don't advertise it. So I would find that quite worrying, because it means we can't actually ascertain the level of need that exists in the Scottish Welfare Fund, so we might not be getting reliable data, but more importantly, not meeting the needs of those who would wish to claim the Scottish Welfare Fund. So I don't know if you can respond to that particular issue, but also, of course, the points that Rachel was making.
Okay, in Glasgow, it's certainly not a secret fund. It's absolutely not. And if anyone asks about it, they'll be properly advised by the advice sector, by Scottish Welfare Fund itself, and by their colleagues in financial services. But I think it was one of your earlier speakers this morning was asking that what there needed to be was effectively some sort of advertising campaign to bring people who are unaware of the Scottish Welfare Fund to make them aware of it. And my point there was that Glasgow is spending its budget to its maximum. Glasgow City Council also puts in its own money to the Scottish Welfare Fund, and the budget to Glasgow has been cut from its original figure down to, I think it's 6 point something million, but it had previously been 8 million. So absolutely would be delighted if there was a resource there to meet demand, but the expectation is that demand is going to go up, and when we come to April next year, and the loss of the £20 per week, demand is going to go up. So a review would be the right way to go forward, preferably a commitment that we don't have a postcode lottery, that if someone is entitled to a payment from the Scottish Welfare Fund, that they get a payment from the Scottish Welfare Fund, and the Scottish Government own the fund, own the budget, and make it available to everybody.
Okay, thank you. And I see, before we move on, I see Sheila, who's not had much of an opportunity to give evidence this morning. Sheila, we'll give the final word on this to you, and then we'll move to Paul Meaney.
It's just a couple of points on the point that Richard has made there. We take quite a different approach in Highland. We proactively do promote the Scottish Welfare Fund. And there was I caught a bit of discussion earlier about ensuring that professionals who support individuals who apply to Scottish Welfare Fund are aware of the scheme. And an earlier speaker had said that 40% weren't aware of the scheme. We take a slightly different approach insofar as we don't expect our professionals who have got lots of knowledge about lots of things to also know about the Scottish Welfare Fund. What we tell our professionals is that they can go to the Citizens Advice, who we fund to 1.1 million, or come into our own welfare support team and income maximisation team. And that's all our professionals are told. They don't need to know the ins and outs of the scheme. They're told the help is available, and if they channel the referral through those teams, they will get the necessary support. And we do full welfare benefit checks, and they get the support that they're entitled to through that. So we do take slightly a different approach in Highland. Thank you.
I think we'll provoke some kind of debate, and I know what are those time constraints. I'll say to fellow MSPs, but I think if there's a kind of different perspective between witnesses, we should explore that a bit further. Richard Gass is requested to comment further.
Yeah, if I came across as saying that Glasgow doesn't promote it, Glasgow does promote it in that we do welfare rights training to voluntary organisations, to social work staff, and that will be in-depth training, but we also get the message out that the fund is there. What I'm saying is that it was the earlier speaker who was wanting something wider, so that, and I don't know if that was leaflets of television campaign or radio campaign, but that would be where there would be a concern that if that were to happen in Glasgow, that the resources were there to meet the expected demand that would be increased.
I think that's very, very interesting, Richard. The last witness panel was talking about a parliamentary report I put out, which contained all the advice lines on the front page of the parliamentary report through 38,000 doors. And the reaction to that was that those telephone numbers for support got used a heck of a lot more than otherwise would have done. But we can't hide from the level of need that's out there. But I note the point that you're making. I do understand that. We'll better move on. Now, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener. It's just one question to the panel, and it's about the discretionary housing payment. Shelter had said that acknowledged that many homeowners who'd lost their jobs won't qualify for social security, but may have difficulty and are not sure that they can apply to the fund. So that's my question. So kind of twofold. One is, don't you think that it's time to maybe revise that housing fund so that it helps people who are short of their rent? Because if we can help people through this difficult period, even if it's temporary, then we'll have less evictions, less people losing their homes. But centrally, I'm interested in whether you think help should be available for homeowners who may have paid into the system all their lives, but right now during this pandemic, many professional people or middle-income people have lost their jobs. And do you think the scheme should include them? Thank you.
Okay, any volunteers to come in on that question? I'm conscious all three of you may not wish to come in. Who would like to come in on this? Paula Doherty.
Thank you. Really, obviously, discretionary housing payments are not currently available for homeowners. And I think if we were to make it available for those customers, we would need to consider the eligibility criteria and how we would determine that they were in need of that grant support. Currently, discretionary housing payment spend is increasing exponentially, and particularly around customers who are on universal credit are able to receive more support than they would have done had they been on housing benefit. This is of significant benefit to, I say the word benefit all the time, significant benefit to these families receiving that support to enable them to meet their housing costs and their wider housing needs. We are very keen to prevent evictions, whether it be from a tenanted property or a homeowner property, and very keen of any suggestions on how we would be able to support the homeowner community, certainly while they are unable to access any DWP support until they have been jobless for a full year.
Thank you.
Richard Gass. Sorry, Richard. Pauline, do you want to come back in on that specific point Paula was making there before I take Richard in?
No, I'd be keen to hear what Richard thinks about that after hearing the question.
Yes, I don't know how many years ago now, 3-4 years ago now, the support for homeowners changed dramatically. You used to get within your DWP means tested benefit housing support, and that was a payment. Now it's a loan. So homeowners are in the situation whereby that the support they get from the state doesn't actually allow them to tread water. DHP, local authorities have got a desperate desire to ensure that folk don't lose their houses, and if there's to be a review of DHP to enable us to provide support to homeowners, and again, a resourced support, then we would welcome that.
Thank you.
And Sheila McCandy.
Thank you, Convener. In my submission, I referred to the mortgage interest support for mortgage interest that Richard has just referred to, which of course is a loan and is paid back with interest. What I suggested in the submission that should be transferred into a grant for a fixed period, because there is a real concern, and certainly our elected members in the Highland Council have got an eye on homeowners, because they don't seem to be accommodated for through existing systems. And this goes back to the point I was making earlier, that existing entitlements haven't flexed to the changing circumstances in which we're all having to live at the moment. So we would like to see the support for mortgage interest converted into a grant rather than a loan. And whether that grant should then be channeled through DHPs, that would be something that local authorities would very much welcome. Whether that's necessary and whether it could just be administered the way it is, but instead of it being a loan, it being a grant, I think that would be very helpful for homeowners. Thank you.
Pauline?
That position, because I do have constituency cases where they have homeowners have used up their holidays, and a number of single parents, and the mortgage is smaller than a rent would be for them, but they're having difficulty meeting that without working, and since there's no provision at the moment. So I thank you for those answers. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thank you, Pauline. And we'll move to Alison Johnson.
Good morning, and thank you, Convener. I just want to take a step back to the Scottish Welfare Fund, if I may. I think we've heard about the numbers being turned down. Martin Canavan in the previous session said that 10% of those engaging with Aberlour had volunteered that they'd applied unsuccessfully. And we've also heard that people are being turned down because they're not in receipt of a qualifying benefit. I'd just like to better understand how many of these people might be eligible. You know, is that a barrier because they simply don't meet the criteria, or is it a barrier because they're unaware about that qualifying benefit?
Okay, Paula Docherty, should we take yourself first?
Thank you very much. I think we certainly wouldn't be refusing customers on the basis that they're not in receipt of a qualifying benefit. The main reason for refusal of a crisis grant is particularly around the customer not being in crisis and having the ability to resolve their situation in other ways. Our success rate, or our award success rate for Scottish Welfare Fund, significantly improved in COVID because we opened up the criteria, because we had extra funding available to provide customers with more support, and particularly around not asking them to take a universal credit advance, which is part of the fund criteria. I think you would have to question whether or not it's a local position on customers being refused for that regard, but we would certainly be awarding customers on the basis that they are on a low income and do not hold that a payment of a benefit is required for an award.
And can I just ask the thank you very much, Paula. Can I ask the local authority representatives, you know, whether you feel that you do have adequate administrative support or administrative capacity to provide support to everyone who requires it, and if there was anything in particular that you would like to see remodelled around the Scottish Welfare Fund?
Sheila?
Received for Scottish Welfare Fund has never been sufficient to meet the provision. The way we have approached that in Highland is we have embedded Scottish Welfare Fund, and I think most local authorities have done this, within their revenues and benefits teams, which means we can move staff around as we get peaks and troughs in applications. So it would be helpful to have more administration funding to meet our actual costs, particularly as local government budgets are being squeezed. That is becoming more difficult. Another reason why Scottish Welfare Fund, particularly crisis grants, are being refused is some individuals have that slight cushion of very small savings. And of course, where they can use those savings to meet the initial crisis, we should not be paying a crisis grant. And that goes back to the point I was making earlier about, should we be waiting for everybody to fall into crisis before we help them, or should we try and prevent that crisis from deteriorating even further? It would be really helpful if we could perhaps help individuals at a higher need rather than waiting for them to get to that lower position.
Thank you.
I'm Richard Gaffes.
I don't actually have the full details as to why folk are being turned down for crisis grants in Glasgow, but it's more likely going to be that folk have either exceeded the number of crisis grants in a particular period, which is there for its repeat applicants, or it's going to be a case of they're applying and we don't recognise that they are in fact in crisis. And I would echo Sheila's point that if we can do something preventative to avoid a crisis arising, then that's a preferable position to waiting for the crisis to happen.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Okay, Alison. I was just dropping the chat box here to let members know who still get outstanding bids for questions. I'm just going to put that on the record so members can see that. I've still got Keith, Tom, Jeremy and Shona, but I would note that Mark Griffin, MSP, has not had an opportunity to intend taking Mark in at this point for a question. And if other MSPs could drop in the chat box if they still have a wish for a question, that would be very helpful. Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Kavina. I just wanted to ask a question about whether members are aware of whether there are any local authorities who have perhaps been more innovative in their use of getting support to people struggling in their areas. We know about the usual channels of free school meals, council tax reductions and things like that, but are any local authorities kind of thinking out the box, doing anything innovative to support their people struggling in their communities?
Sheila, do you want to? Oh, Richard Gass has dropped R in the chat box. Richard, we should take you first.
I know that our colleagues in Education Services who are intending to get a payment out this side of Christmas for all the school meals to the end of the school academic year, but they're also going to have a look at data within data sharing regulations, of course, have a look at what information we already hold so that we can identify those who maybe do qualify for free school meals but haven't taken up the entitlement. That's one innovative area. However, that then brings on the issue of we need to have something across all councils where we can, if we hold information where we can identify that someone has an entitlement, we should have the legal powers to be proactive to take that information to people.
Sheila McCandy.
Many years ago in Highland, we introduced a single application form for council-administered benefits, and that includes free school meals. So when somebody applies for that, they do a single application form, they provide their evidence once, and we will put whichever entitlements that they may have, and there's 9 entitlements, we will put those into payment. That includes the free school meals, of course. Where we have got families who are identifying they need some support with food, if they don't qualify for free school meals, we provide them with food. And we've been putting out significant numbers of food parcels in the last month that's just passed, 2,600, just in excess of 2,600 food parcels. Now that's doorstep deliveries and deliveries via community groups. And that number just keeps growing. It's absolutely significant what we're putting out. So there's a couple of things we're doing in Highland. We're very proactive about looking across our data sets where we've got authority from the applicant, of course, to do that, and being proactive in contacting individuals and inviting claims. Our assistance advice group, team and our welfare support team work hand in glove. And again, they're very proactive. We do lots of social feeds. We do lots of advertising, lots of marketing, to try and, with professionals and with potential applicants, to try and ensure that people do understand that it is help. They might not understand the technicalities of what the help is. They might not understand eligibility criteria. We don't expect them to. What we do encourage them to do is to access the advice that's available to them, and then we take it from there. Where there are adverse decisions, we will appeal and challenge those on behalf of the applicant, with their consent, of course, and we've got a high success rate in doing so. There's quite a few things that we're doing at local authority level, and I'm sure it's the same across lots of local authorities.
Paula Docherty?
Probably at the moment, I'm just echoing what Sheila has said. You know, our customers are encouraged to come to us if they need any help and support, or if someone thinks someone needs to help and support. We have significantly funded the Assistance Advice Service to support our working age people, and have our welfare support team to support our pensioner cohort. We also have a group of staff who work closely with our homelessness service around housing options and supporting customers financially as best we can to prevent that homelessness. I don't necessarily know whether it would be classed as innovative, but as I mentioned earlier, because of all our benefits are sitting together, with the customer's consent, we would certainly look at all of the benefits that we have available to ensure that we meet that customer's immediate needs and their ongoing needs as best we can. What we don't want to do administratively, because I think Sheila and others have all mentioned, the local authority is under significant financial pressure. We don't have admin resources to go out and start targeting customers constantly. However, we can, when we're dealing with a customer, hopefully resolve the issues as best we can at that point, ongoing, and then they wouldn't have to come back to us so often. But that requires the financial support being available, which thankfully at the moment we do have. My concerns come when we're talking about the future years, if we don't have this funding available, customers are used to receiving it, we are used to having it to be able to provide, and if it's not available in the future, then it will be a double whammy for many.
Alison, did you want to come back in on any of that before we move on? I think Alison, you've had to head off there. I'm just checking.
But, Convener, I'm assuming you mean me, since it was my question.
Sorry, Mark. Yes, that would be helpful. Not Alison Johnson, but Mark Griffin. You can see him on the ball this morning. My apologies. On you go.
Thanks, Peter. It's just briefly, I mean, I'm hearing the same issues that we always seem to hear around data sharing and data sets from the DWP about who qualifies for certain benefits, which would probably help local authorities target people if they could. Are those restrictions around data stopping local authorities being as responsive as they might wish to be in targeting support and helping people in communities?
Okay, who would like to go first on that? Okay, let's take Richard Gass then. I don't see a volunteer, Mr. Gass.
I think Sheila did have her hand up, but I'll jump in here anyway. There's real restrictions on the use of DWP data in relation to free school meals. Not quite so restrictive in Glasgow for school clothing grants. In Glasgow, we have council tax reduction qualifying benefit for school clothing grants. So what we were able to do was to ask ourselves the question, does someone get a council tax reduction, yes or no? And we were permitted, because we run council tax reduction, what we were permitted to do was to say, well, how did you arrive at that decision relating to council tax reduction? You'd use that for free school meals. We were allowed to ask ourselves the question, does somebody get council tax reduction, yes or no? The answer is yes, you get a school clothing grant. So we've used it insofar as we believe we legally can, but we were kind of restrained by the fact that we know that we glean so much about the population in Glasgow. If someone's applied to Glasgow for help with their council tax, they're indicating to the council that they need some financial support. It just feels that we fall a bit short if we can't give them 100% of that support.
Okay, and Sheila now.
Discussed this with the committee before, what I'm going to raise. So the benefit cap is applied either through housing benefit or through universal credit. When it is applied through a housing benefit, the local authority then invites a claim for discretionary housing payments, and we put that into payment to bridge the gap where it's applicable. We don't receive that data for universal credit. So we cannot identify and be proactive for those individuals who are impacted by the benefit cap. We cannot give them the additional discretionary support through the discretionary housing payment system. And it's something that we have lobbied DWP for very hard. And in any consultation that touches on benefit cap or universal credit, we introduce this conversation. And I think that's why I've discussed it with yourselves before. So it'd be very, very helpful if there is any influence that can be made to enable that data share, because we are really concerned, particularly for individuals in the private rented sector who perhaps don't have the support around them and aren't aware of the support that is available to them to access the discretionary housing payments, and they're severely impacted by benefit cap. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Sheila. Paula Doherty?
I think I would welcome any opportunities to receive a better data share to enable us to support our customers. We would proactively contact customers who are in receipt of council tax reduction and they have children to invite an application for free school meals. However, it would be very handy if we didn't have to invite the application and we were able just to award without request. We have customers who we're contacting numerous times to say, can you put in an application? Can we help you with an application? And they're just not doing so. Now, that may be because they have a a stigma attached to receiving free school meals or other ways, but it's just, it's quite unfortunate that we can't just put the meals in payment and award the grant without that application.
Matt Griffin, I've got the name right this time. Do you want to come back?
Thanks, Kavina. No further questions.
Okay. So we have one further question from Jeremy Balfour, unless I see anything else in the chat.
Thank you. It's really just to follow up some of what you've been saying about how do we administrate this the best way. And obviously, we now have the new Social Security Agency up and running here in Scotland. And I'm just wondering, do you think there needs to be maybe a spreading of the load, so some is now taken on by the new agency, do it more centrally, to free up local authorities to do other things? Or do you think it should stay as it is, with each local authority administrating it themselves, with 32 different systems in place?
Okay, any volunteers for this? I should point out, I put it in the chat, my reception is dreadful, so I can't actually see if anyone's making a bid to speak, so I'll just have to pick someone. Sheila McCandy.
Thank you for the question, it's very helpful. View of our elected members in Highland Council is they would like to see the agency further devolved. They would like to see the funding that is going into the agency spread across Scotland, because it will create sustainable employment, well-paid employment, and at this time of economic downturn, that's what all local authorities need. So we would like to see further devolution of the agency, not more going into the agency. We'd like to see that devolved out to local authorities. We've got the infrastructure in place. Some of the costs, I was looking up the costs, and I think I put it into the submission, the agency's costs are increasing from what they thought they would be. So we could possibly help with that, and we do think that there is a role for local authorities in the delivery of social security in Scotland.
Thank you. Paula Docherty.
Thank you. I would just echo Sheila's comments. We certainly in rural Dumfries and Galloway, much like rural Highland, we would welcome further devolution of social security, and so that support and employment opportunities are available across Scotland, to ensure that we meet the needs of all our customers and all our residents.
And Richard Gass.
Yeah, well, I can't tell you what Glasgow's position would be on devolution of more of Social Security Scotland, but one thing I can say is that we would prefer there to be better joined up thinking in relation to council tax reduction, Scottish Welfare Fund, and the new Scottish Social Security benefits, that Social Security Scotland could take the lead responsibility for Scottish Welfare Fund and council tax reduction, albeit they're delivered by local authorities, then there's at least there's all the decision making and thinking are in the one place, and we might not then get continually new benefits being introduced that don't have council tax reduction as the qualifying benefit. But let's recognise council tax reduction is the one means-tested benefit within the control of the Scottish Government, and it's the one UK means-tested benefit that doesn't employ a two-child policy.
Jim Balfour, do you want to come back with that?
No, I think that's been helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Can I just ask a brief question in relation to free school meals? First of all, this question is inspired not by what's happening in England just now, but actually the progress we've made in Scotland over a number of years in extending into free school meals, and the success of local authorities with their holiday hunger programmes across Scotland. We've now moved to a position where we are having effectively cash to local authorities to enable free school meals during holiday periods. So this Christmas, at Easter and the summer, which is really positive, and we've heard the intention of a lot of that to be cash payments, and we seem to be moving towards a more structured, possibly temporary system, a more structured system, providing additional cash support for families in need over holiday periods. So is there any reflections from the witnesses in relation to how we take forward. Of course, we have to find cash to fund all this, but just in terms of coordinating the approach to hunger and free school meals and the good work that's been going on just now, but how do we take that forward and weave it into a more progressive social security system? Shall we go for Richard Gass, perhaps?
I see that both Paula, well, Paula's got her hand up, so maybe you want to take her.
Yeah, I absolutely apologise, Paula. I cannot see a thing on my screen here. Paula Docherty.
That's quite all right. Dumfries and Galloway have been doing direct payments and recompense for free school meals since May. We continued that payment, and it's at £17.50 per week per child throughout the summer period, and expanded the eligibility to include those families who are in receipt of council tax reduction. We continued the payment throughout the October holidays and paid £40 per eligible child. However, at that point, prior to the Scottish Government's commitment to funding, was only to those families who are eligible under the Scottish Government free school meals criteria. I would welcome Richard's point earlier around council tax reduction and it being a qualifying benefit for much of this support, because council tax reduction is tapered support and takes into account the size of your family and your income, and it's not got a cliff edge to that degree. However, what I would also mention is Dumfries and Galloway is one of the lowest council tax charges in Scotland. So if we were looking to provide that support, there may be some need to consider the impact, obviously, of a lower council tax reduction charge means council tax reduction ends earlier for many families. So it's just around making sure that there's some sort of parity across the country for that. Dumfries and Galloway charges are around £3 per week less than Edinburgh City, not having looked at many others, but it is certainly one of the lowest council tax charges in mainland Scotland.
Thank you, Kat. Does Sheila or Richard wish, I'm flying blind a little bit here, I have to admit, does Sheila or Richard wish to, I saw Sheila's hand, Sheila McCandy, thank you.
I'm the same as you, convener. I can't see anything on the chat either. Yes, I was just going to say, we pay £15 per pupil per week, and we pay around 4,500 pupils at any given time. So in a fortnight, it's about £135,000. What I am very conscious of, though, and it's just been highlighted in the discussion today, though, in Dumfries and Galloway, it's £17.50 per week. In Highland, it's £15 per week. And perhaps there should be more parity across across Scotland in terms of how much we pay. We pay slightly, but the way we calculated it was and arrived at the £15 per week was we looked at, well, what does it cost to provide a school meal? And parents don't have that purchasing power. So we inflated the amount that we pay to families. There are many families who come forward and ask us for additional support over and above free school meals during the holiday period, and that's when we supply the food on top of the free school meal entitlement. So those individuals who currently are just above that entitlement for free school meals, we are providing them with food, but we're also providing that to individuals who receive free school meals as well. We are
Please continue, Sheila, and you go.
Sorry, I was just going to bring in the self-isolation support grants. So where individuals are asked, or where pupils are asked to self-isolate, sometimes what we find is other pupils self-isolate, and that's a parental choice. So they don't receive their free school meal entitlement because they've made that choice, but what we do is provide them with food instead.
That's a very helpful point that I don't think the committee's been aware of, Sheila, and can also thank you for identifying that relationship between the holiday hunger programmes that have been hugely successful and the cash payments for free school meals, because of course every young person won't qualify, and if you're just the wrong side of the qualification criteria, you may still have significant issues in getting the food you need. That's a really important point. Richard, and do you want to make any final comments on this before we close this particular evidence session?
No, I think, well, not on the free school meals, but if there was something that the committee wanted to do, be to address the three things in relation to the £20 universal credit. One, I think there's already been a commitment that there's going to be a recommendation that should continue. But secondly, that £20 is not available within ESA income support or job seekers allowance. What that's forcing folk to do is, if they want the extra £20, they need to give up their legacy benefits, make a claim for a new benefit at a time when support services maybe aren't as readily accessible. And if there's a recognition that extra money is required by people in that situation, why can't it also be available to those legacy means-tested benefits? And finally, the benefit cap was not increased. So a family with three children who were subject to the benefit cap might celebrate the fact they're going to get an extra £20 universal credit, only to find they don't get it because they've already reached the benefit cap. So the benefit cap is denying families with children, larger families, the extra support that's supposed to be available.
Okay, thank you, Richard. And my apologies to Sheila and Paula. We're out of time. I'm sure you'll echo those comments as well without putting words in your mouth. I'm pretty sure you would do. We have to leave the evidence session there. Can I thank Richard Gath, Sheila McCandy, Paula Dockerton, of course, Sally Dyson and Martin Canavan from our first evidence session for all your support this morning for our inquiry. That concludes agenda item 2, and we now move to agenda item 3, which will be taken in private. We now move into private session on our platform. Thank you everyone again for bearing with us for the technical difficulties also. Thank you.